What are you looking for? And have you found it yet? We can spend a lot of our lives chasing after something that is just out of reach. The next move, the next job, the next relationship, even the next distraction. Whatever it is always just ahead, or perhaps just behind. In any case, it isn't here. We hope that the future will be better than the past, or at least no worse. It is easy to spend much of our lives restlessly, looking for something better, or at least different. It is so very hard to be present sometimes, because we're chasing something elusive, that ideal job, partner, opportunity for yourself or for your children, that ideal life. In this morning's reading from John's Gospel, Jesus encounters two men who were searching for something more. They are disciples of John the Baptist. They have been hanging out with John for some time, but when Jesus comes along, John points them after him. Maybe this new teacher will have what they've been looking for. Perhaps they'll be able to say, "This is the one." John is certainly excited about him. "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world," he says. Whatever that means. Jesus asks these two men who start to follow after him, "What are you looking for?" Knows that they're chasing after something. They respond by asking him, "Rabbi, where are you staying?" Jesus replies, "Come and see." And presumably, they did. But what exactly did the two find? They went to see where Jesus was staying. But what was it about that visit that caused Andrew to go and say to his brother Simon, "I found the Messiah"? The gospel doesn't say. Something more happened with Jesus. But what? We start to get an idea if we look closely at the language that the gospel uses. Some of the hints that it gives. Five times in four verses of this passage, John uses the same verb. It is the Greek verb meno, which means abide or remain, stay, dwell, endure, be present, that sort of meaning. And this word is a very important word in the Gospel of John. It bears later a great deal of theological meaning. John uses this verb 69 times in his gospel, and the noun, which we might call abode, right, twice. In the 15th chapter of John's gospel, for instance, we read, "Abide in me, as I abide in you." If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide, rest, dwell in my love. In the letters from John also, the same use of this word occurs. In 1 John chapter 4, God abides in those that confess that Jesus is the Son of God. They abide in God. So we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. The verb abide is always an active verb for St. John. When one abides, certain actions will follow, 1 John 2, whoever says, I abide in him, ought to walk just as he, Jesus, walked. To abide in Jesus will result in a life that is more and more conformed to Jesus' life. And so if we go back to today's reading from the first chapter of John and render meno consistently as abide, it sounds like this. And John testified, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abided on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, he on whom you see the Spirit descend and abide is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, what are you looking for? And they said to him, Rabbi, where are you abiding? He said to them, come and see. They came and saw where he was abiding, and they abided with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. John the Baptist's disciples wanted to see where Jesus was abiding, his home, where he was resting. They wanted to stay with him and learn from him. But the use of this word in John points to the fact that what they got there is something more, something much closer to the life of God and the life of faith, abiding in that God. Later in the 14th chapter of John's Gospel, Jesus tells them about his Father's house, where there are many abodes. That is, places to abide. In my Father's house there are many abodes. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? Jesus answered them, those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our abode with them. We, the Son and the Father, come to those who love them, who keep this word, and will abide with them. And so asking to see where Jesus abides may have been a simple question to the two who asked him, but Jesus called them into something more. The good news of God in Christ is that we can abide with God, and he with us. And so Jesus showed them more than just where he slept at night. Jesus showed them how they can rest in God just as he rests in us. There's one more clue in the text that makes this even more clear and more profound. The Gospel of John does not casually refer to time. We have that weird little section. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So what? Well, John uses references to time to teach. And when we read this passage in the full context of the events that follow in the Gospel of John, we discover something really interesting about what must have happened on that day of the week. If we read on in John, it says that the next day, Jesus leaves the two disciples and calls Philip and then Nathanael. And then we see again, have another point about time. 3 days later, Jesus is at the wedding in Cana, where he performs that first miracle of water into wine. And universally at that time, almost as today with Saturdays, weddings were always on Wednesdays in the first century. And so if you count back the 4 days that have passed, you'll find that it would have been 4 o'clock in the afternoon on Friday when Andrew and a friend asked Jesus where he was abiding. This is getting late into the afternoon, evening would be coming soon, the sun would be going down, and the Sabbath would be beginning. The two men likely were hinting about spending the Sabbath with this new teacher, taking time to rest and to eat together and to pray on that last day of the week when God rested and pointed to God's creation as the place where God rests. So the two that want to know where Jesus abides is exemplified by the Jewish Sabbath. That question of where Jesus abides is not just where he lays his head, but how he rests, who he is with, namely the Father. And so it is, it seems, in spending Sabbath time with Jesus that the disciples of John the Baptist come to truly become disciples of Jesus of Nazareth. After this intimate time of prayer, this 24 hours of time close with the Messiah, resting and praying and sitting and talking with him, is Andrew able to go and tell his brother Simon, "I found the Messiah. Come and see," Jesus says to the disciples and to us today. But this is a different invitation than any other that we might ever receive. The world, the television, the Facebook page practically scream, "Come and see," and then move on to the next thing. But Jesus' call to come and see is a call to come and to see and to abide. The disciples ask for a quick visit while hinting at something more. And Jesus invited them into true rest. Jesus showed the two where he truly abides, in the Father, and where they might abide, might find their rest in him. Later in John 15, Jesus gives this image of abiding. "I am the vine and you are the branches. Abide in me," he says, "and you will bear much fruit. For if a branch does not remain connected to the vine, it dies." So too do we require a connection to God. We need to abide in Jesus. Before we allow the rest of our lives to so demand time that we have nothing left over to give to God, we need to abide for our spiritual rest and refreshment. We need to abide. And this is not an easy lesson for our hectic lives. Many of us have built our lives, have ordered our lives to everything other than rest in God. It is easier for us to chase after the next thing or look for a more perfect time. There is a perverse comfort and familiarity to our restlessness. But Jesus challenges us to stop, to abide in him. Abiding in Jesus means things like spending time in prayer, spending time reading Scripture. It means pausing in the midst of our busyness to give thanks for the good things we have and cast all those cares that drive us to distraction on him. Most of us have movement down. We can look to the future and look to the past. We can keep moving. Jesus' call to us is to abide, to remain, to sojourn, to continue, to be present in him. And the good news for us who find this a struggle is that Jesus is already present in our hearts by the power of the Holy Spirit. He abides in you, and he's calling you to abide in him. May we rest in that love that God has for us. In the name of the Father, and the Son,